have 10 minutes. I'm going to cover radioligand therapy for the treatment of metastatic castration-resistant prostate cancer, or mCRPC. And for the sake of time, I won't really talk about Xofigo or radium-223, but if there are questions, please come find me afterwards. Okay, so what is radioligand therapy? So as the name implies, radioligand therapy is a treatment where you have a radioactive element that emits cancer-killing radiation, and then you have a ligand. You have a small molecule, typically, or an antibody that helps to carry the radioactive payload and direct it into your cancer cells. So in the case of lutetium PSMA, we have lutetium-177, which emits beta particles. It's a type of radioactive energy. And then you have PSMA-617. It's a small molecule that binds to the PSMA receptor. And what it does is that it takes lutetium, it binds to the receptor, it gets internalized or taken up inside of the cells, and it allows you to accumulate your radioactive source inside of the patient's tumors. One of the features of radioligand therapies that's, I would say, distinguishes them a little bit from other types of treatments is that we can often pair them with a companion diagnostic agent. So in the case of lutetium PSMA, you can use the same small molecule, but instead of attaching lutetium to it, you can use something like gallium that emits benign radiation, which is not going to kill the cancer, but that can be detected on the PET scanner. And what that allows you to do concretely is that when you're seeing a patient and you're considering treating them with lutetium PSMA, you can first check a PSMA PET scan to make sure that they're adequate candidates. So if you look at this example here, you can see the leftmost figure is a PSMA PET scan. And you can see this is a man with widespread metastases that light up on the PSMA PET scan. But actually, if you look in the same patient on a sugar PET scan, you can see that there are additional areas of disease, I'll highlight them here, in the liver that are metabolically active metastases, but that do not express PSMA. So this patient would actually not be a good candidate for lutetium PSMA. It would probably be better served with chemotherapy. And with a PSMA PET scan, you're able to make that judgment up front instead of trying a treatment that potentially would not benefit them. And fortunately, you know, this is to make the point. Fortunately, the majority of patients are eligible. So if you just look at eligibility by PET criteria, it's only about 12% of cases where, for one reason or another, we'll think that the individual is not a good candidate for PSMA-directed treatment. Okay, so then I'm going to talk about three trials that help to define how we use lutetium PSMA in men with mCRPC. And the first one is the VISION trial, which some of you may have heard about before. This was a large registrational study. It was funded by Novartis to get their drug lutetium PSMA-617, or Pluvicto, approved for men with mCRPC. And what they did, they looked at patients that exhausted most of the established treatments for prostate cancer. They had progressed on a hormone pill, they had progressed on chemotherapy, and were not eligible to receive more chemo. And so these men were randomized to either standard of care, which was a pretty limited toolbox of treatments, like a switch to a different hormone pill, targeted radiation or supportive measures, or to receive up to six cycles of lutetium PSMA, which we gave as an infusion once every 6 weeks. And the study was positive. So they showed, these are relative risk reductions, but they showed a 60% reduction in the risk of progression with lutetium PSMA, and about a 40% reduction in the risk of death, which improved in that study the median overall survival. So the time by which half of the participants had passed away from 11 months to 15 months with Pluvicto treatments. And so shortly after this study, in March of 2022, the FDA granted approval for Pluvicto, again, at this time for the treatment of men who had progressed on a hormone pill and who had already received chemotherapy. The therapy trial, this is the second trial I'm going to talk about. This is a smaller academic study, so it was run out of Australia. But it's worth talking about because what they did is they looked at men who had progressed on a hormone pill, who had received docetaxel, who were still eligible for cabazitaxel chemotherapy. And what they did is they randomized them to either cabazitaxel or to six cycles of Pluvicto. And because it was an academic study, they had a perhaps less clinically meaningful endpoint, but they looked at rates of PSA response, and they showed that these were much higher with Pluvicto than with chemotherapy. In this study, which was not designed for this, and so may have missed a small difference in survival, but there was no significant difference in survival in the two arms, which again highlights that chemotherapy is still a very effective treatment for prostate cancer. But the reason I wanted to talk about this study, I think to me the most interesting aspect of it is that they looked at patient-reported outcomes. So they gave questionnaires to have patients fill out as they were receiving treatment, either lutetium or cabazitaxel. And what you can see is everything to the right of the vertical line and to the right of zero means that the answers, the scores were better for men being treated with Pluvicto than with chemo. And if you looked specifically at what was very diplomatically called troublesome symptoms, like diarrhea, lightheadedness, hair loss, abnormal taste, the likelihood of having these significant symptoms was much less with Pluvicto than with chemo. And so I think the point is that, you know, not only is Pluvicto more effective than chemotherapy, but also better tolerated. So then if you think about the continuum or the disease spectrum of prostate cancer, the therapy and the vision trial established Pluvicto as a treatment option at the very end for men who had already progressed on hormone pills, who had already received chemotherapy. As you can imagine, one obvious next question was then to ask whether if this worked well before, after chemotherapy, whether it would also benefit patients who had not yet been treated with chemotherapy. And there were three large trials that asked this question. We actually participated in Eclipse, but I'll talk about PSMA-4, which was the first to present its results. And so what the PSMA-4 trial did is they looked at patients, again, who had not yet received chemotherapy or just progressed on one hormone pill. And in that study, patients were either treated with a switch from one pill to the next, so from abiraterone to enzalutamide or vice versa. And in the experimental arm, they were given up to six cycles of Pluvicto. And the study was again positive, so they showed a 60% reduction almost in the risk of progression with Pluvicto relative to the strategy of switching to another hormone pill. And that meant the median time to progression was more than doubled with Pluvicto treatment. Importantly, the study was designed so that if patients had been assigned to the hormone pill and progressed, they were offered treatment with Pluvicto. And with that, at least so far, we haven't seen a significant difference in survival between the two approaches. But nevertheless, with these results, as of barely a little over a month ago, the FDA expanded the label so that Pluvicto is now an option for patients who've progressed on a hormone pill, even if they have not yet received chemotherapy. So if you go back to the disease continuum, this is where lutetium PSMA, I think for a lot of patients, will now be as almost a first-line treatment once you develop castration-resistant disease. And as you can imagine, the studies that are ongoing are looking to see whether this may be beneficial for patients who have not yet progressed on hormone therapy. So we have the PSMA addition trial that's ongoing, but that will look at adding Pluvicto to our standard doublet of ADT plus a hormone pill. And then we also, there's a study which we're actually part of now, looking at giving lutetium PSMA for patients with a rise in PSA after surgery or radiation prior to any hormone therapy. As you can imagine, we're really excited about both of these trials. So the last slide before I conclude, I wanted to talk about ways we can do better. This is obviously an effective treatment. It's generally well tolerated, but it's not a perfect treatment. So there are some men who will not respond and others who will respond initially, but invariably will develop resistance. And so how can we do better? I think there it helps to conceptualize, to think about what are the ways in which lutetium PSMA may not work. These are not the only mechanism, but the ones I'll highlight. So the first one is you may have tumors that express some PSMA but have low uptake. So you're not getting a lot of your drug inside of the tumor cells. And so one approach to try to address this is to use PET scan, as I've mentioned, to select the right patient. But I think a more promising approach is to try to look at combinations. Are there other treatments, drugs we can add in addition to Pluvicto that may increase the expression of PSMA? I think another common mechanism of resistance is you may have cells that express a lot of PSMA but are just inherently more resistant to the cancer-killing effects of radiation. And so for these, we have a lot of trials looking at combining lutetium PSMA with radiosensitizers, medications that will make cancer cells more susceptible to radiation. But another approach also is to try to give higher doses of radiation. So that may mean higher doses of Pluvicto, dosing Pluvicto more frequently, but also having radioligand therapies that have a more potent radioactive payload. One in particular is actinium PSMA. Actinium emits alpha particles, unlike lutetium, which emits beta particles, so radiation energy that you can get into the cells. And then the last mechanism is you have heterogeneity. So you may have someone with bright PSMA-avid disease on PET scan, but if you could look at the cells under the microscope, you would see that some cells express PSMA, but there are cells that also do not. And so I think here, focus is trying to identify other targets on the surface of those PSMA-negative cells that we could go after with a similar approach. So to summarize, radioligand therapy, it enables us to deliver radiation, a radioactive isotope, in a targeted fashion inside of prostate cancer cells. And often, as I've said, one of the strengths of this approach is that we can pair this with a diagnostic agent that helps us make sure that we're getting the right treatment into the right patient. Right now, it's approved for men who have mCRPC and PSMA-avid disease and progress on at least one AR-targeted therapy, regardless of whether they've received chemo, but there are several trials that are ongoing to investigate this in patients who have not yet progressed on hormone therapy. And then the same theragnostic approach, so combining, once you have a target, combining a diagnostic agent with a therapeutic agent is being applied actively to other targets. And it may be that in the future, with PET scans, we'll be able to select the right treatment based on the patient's characteristics.